Now, we've all seen them. The ribbon cutting ceremonies to dedicate a building or some place or something. And so in 1 Kings chapter 8, we're going to see that they do the exact same thing. They have a ribbon cutting ceremony, for lack of a better description. There's going to be a dedication of the temple. Now, what's happened is for over 400 years, they have worshipped in a tent. It's called a tabernacle, which is a big fancy word for a tent. So they're worshipping in this tent, Now, they finally built a permanent building. So they want to dedicate it. And I figure it's probably more enjoyable to worship in a permanent building than in a tent. All right. That kind of response, we're not going to keep up this building. We'll just let it fall apart. We'll just meet in a tent. That seems to be your preference. I would think meeting in a permanent building is probably better than meeting in a tent. Yeah, still not convinced me, but we'll let it slide. All right, so beginning verse, well, first 11 verses, if you're going to have this temple dedicated, the most important thing is that the presence of God is there. So notice what it says. Then Solomon is the king. Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the leaders of the fathers' houses of the people of Israel, before King Solomon in Jerusalem, to bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord out of the city of David, which is Zion. And all the men of Israel assembled to King Solomon at the feast in the month Ethanim, which is the seventh month. Now this feast is the Feast of Tabernacles, or Feast of Booths, or Sukkot. And basically what they did was they camped in their backyard in stick huts. And be out for a week. And so the idea was that during this time, you would be more thankful for the houses that you now have in the land, and for the wells, and for the fields, and all these things. So it was a time to remember when we had nothing, and now we have this. That's very fitting that they are to remember we used to live in tents, now we live in buildings. God used to be worshiped in a tent, now he's worshiped in a building. So Solomon strategically scheduled this dedication. So in verse 3, all the elders of Israel came. And they brought up the Ark of the Lord, the tent of meeting, and all the holy vessels that were in the tent. The priests and the Levites brought them up. And King Solomon and all the congregation of Israel who had assembled before him were with him before the Ark, sacrificing so many sheep and oxen that they could not be counted or numbered. Then the priests brought the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place in the inner sanctuary of the house, in the most holy place, also called the Holy of Holies, underneath the wings of the cherubim. For the cherubim spread out their wings over the place of the Ark, so that the cherubim overshadowed the Ark and the poles. The poles were so long that the ends of the poles were seen from the holy place before the inner sanctuary, but they could not be seen from the outside, and they are there to this day. There was nothing in the ark except two tablets of stone that Moses put there at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the people of Israel when they came out of the land of Egypt. Now, all this discussion, why is the ark so important? Well, on the top of the ark, the lid for the Ark of Covenant, was called the mercy seat. Now, what do you do with the seat? You sit in. That's right. So whose seat is it? It was God's seat. It's God's throne. So the things they brought the throne of God into the Holy of Holies, into the most holy place, so that God could come and dwell and abide with his people. So verse 10, look what happens when they bring it in. And when the priest came out of the holy place, a cloud filled the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. So in the Old Testament, the primary way that God reveals himself is through the pillar of cloud. And so they brought in the Ark of the Covenant, they brought in God's throne, his seat, and now God's presence so fills the temple that they cannot even go into the building. I don't know about you, but I think it would be awesome if we showed up some Sunday and we could not even get into the building because the presence of God was so powerful in this place. And so they have to go out. It's there's incredible presence of God. Now, why did God do this? Because he wants to certify that this is the place where worship will happen. And there's kind of a path that flows to the Bible on this. So the first place that was approved for worship was the tabernacle. So in Exodus chapter 40, verses 34 to 38, we find the dedications, and we'll put them up here on the screen so you can get them, for those of you who like to take notes. There we go. So Exodus chapter 34, they constructed the tabernacle. Now, what happens when they construct the tabernacle? They bring the Ark of the Covenant in. Guess what happens when they bring in the Ark of the Covenant? The tent is so filled with the cloud of the presence of God, they can't get in. Sound familiar? So God is saying, I ordain, I recognize the tabernacle as a place of worship. now in 1 Kings chapter 8, and it's repeated again in 2 Chronicles chapter 5, we find that the presence of God fills the temple. And so he says, now this is the proof place of worship. But what about the New Testament? What happens? Well, in John chapter 1, verse 14, the Bible says that the Word, Jesus, most translations have dwelt among us, but literally it is tabernacled among us, pitched his tent among us. So Jesus is now the approved place of worship. But there's a problem. Jesus left. He died and rose again, and 4 days later he went back to heaven. So Jesus sent someone in his place. Who did Jesus send in his place when he left? Yes, you weren't sure, but you're correct. The Holy Spirit. So in Acts chapter 1, the Bible says that Jesus went up, and in Acts chapter 2, it says that the Holy Spirit came down. And when the Holy Spirit came down, the room was shaken, and fire settled on the top of the head of each of the apostles. Everybody was in the room. And the pillar was not just a pillar of cloud, but at night it shone as a pillar of fire. And so this harkens back to God saying, now you, my people, are the approved place of worship. So if you have the Holy Spirit in you because you belong to Jesus Christ, you are an approved place of worship by God. But not just you as an individual, but we as a congregation, we as the body of Christ, we are an approved place of worship. According to Ephesians chapter 2, we are the temple of God, the holy of holies of God. When we gather together, God approves of us worshiping Him here together with one another. But it would still get it right. They're still not as it could be and should be. That's okay, because according to Revelation chapter 21, the day is coming when the temple of God will dwell with men. When we shall be in the Holy of Holies. When we shall be around the throne of God. And we shall see Him in all of His glory. And we shall worship Him in heaven forever and ever and ever as the final approved place of worship. And the cool thing is that we will experience the incredible presence of God, but we'll be able to stay. We won't have to leave the building. And so, the presence of God is here. Solomon is now going to respond to this by offering praise to God. Look at verse 12. Then Solomon said, the Lord has said that He would dwell in thick darkness. Now, wait a minute. Why would God surround Himself with thick darkness? Well, here's the reason. God is holy, and you ain't. And when not holy comes into the presence of holy, not holy dies. So, for our protection, God surrounds Himself with a thick darkness so that we can be in His presence, but not behold Him in all of His glory. So, here's the idea. Through life, you and I will get glimpses of the glory of God. But it is not until we are ready for His full glory in heaven that we will see it revealed. So, He says that He has surrounded Himself for our protection in thick darkness. And now, He's going to just celebrate. I have indeed built you an exalted house, a place for you to dwell in forever. Then the king turned around and blessed all the assembly of Israel while all the assembly of Israel stood. And he said, blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who with His hand has fulfilled what He promised with His mouth to David, my father, saying, since the day that I brought my people Israel out of Egypt, I chose no city out of all the tribes of Israel in which to build a house, that my name might be there. But I chose David to be over my people Israel. Now it was in the heart of David, my father, to build a house for the name of the Lord, the God of Israel. But the Lord said to David, my father, whereas it was in your heart to build a house for my name, you did well that it was in your heart. Nevertheless, verse 19, you shall not build a house, but your son who shall be born to you shall build a house for my name. Now the Lord has fulfilled His promise that He made. For I have risen in the place of David, my father, to sit on the throne of Israel, as the Lord promised, and I have built the house for the name of the Lord, the God of Israel. So he celebrates that God has fulfilled His promise to David, and celebrates that the house of the Lord has been built. But more than that, verse 21, he celebrates the covenant of God. And there I have provided a place for the ark, in which is the covenant of the Lord that He made with our fathers when He brought them out of the land of Egypt. When God brought them out of Egypt, Exodus 19 was a worship service, where God entered into covenant with His people. Here's what He is saying, that you and I don't just recognize that God is King, but we also recognize that we are His and He is ours. We belong to Him and He belongs to us. He is our God and we are His people and we are in covenant with Him. Now, Solomon doesn't do something in these verses. He doesn't ask for anything. All he does is praise God. So I'm going to give you a homework assignment for this week, and some of you, this is going to be extremely difficult. Here's the assignment. I want you each day to take just a couple of minutes, somewhere out of your day, and praise God without asking for anything. Now, there'll be those of you that have to try this 3 or 4 times, because you'll get about a minute and a half in, start asking for stuff, and you'll start all over again. But just praise God. Listen, prayer does not always mean asking for stuff. It is okay to just praise God. Just celebrate who He is and how great and awesome and wonderful and fantastic and glorious and majestic and all the other adjectives that we can come up with to describe Him. Just take time every day to praise God. Move your request time to some other time in the day. But take just a couple of minutes. You're going to be stuck for an hour in traffic at some point this week. Turn off the radio for 2 minutes and just praise God. Let me tell you what will happen. You will have a better week. Because God has designed us to be praisers. We are designed to be worshipers. And so just take a couple of minutes each day just to praise God. God is always worthy of our praise. And so just don't make any requests. Just spend a couple minutes praising God. Now, when you're done with that, when you're done praising Him, it's okay to ask for stuff, because that's exactly what Solomon's going to do in verse 12. So he praises Him, then there's a stop, and then we find a prayer in verse 12. So the presence of God has led to praise to God, and now we're going to find a prayer to God. And this is a long prayer. And so I'm going to read through the whole thing, and then we'll go back to just one thing I really want to point out in this. It's kind of the dominant idea. Verse 12. Then Solomon said, "The Lord has said that He will dwell." Verse 22. Verse 22. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands toward heaven and said, "O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like You in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to Your servants who walk before You with all their heart. You have kept with Your servant David, my father, what You declared to him. You spoke with Your mouth, and with Your hand have fulfilled it this day." He just got through praising God, and when he begins to pray, he just can't help but praise Him a little bit more. It's always okay to praise God. And so, he started, "Now therefore," verse 25, "O Lord, God of Israel, keep for Your servant David, my father, what You have promised him, saying, 'You shall not like a man to sit before Me on the throne of Israel. If only Your sons pay close attention to their way, to walk before Me as You have walked before Me. Now therefore, O God of Israel, let Your word be confirmed, which You have spoken to Your servant David, my father. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain You. How much less this house that I have built? Yet have regard to the prayer of Your servant and to his plea, O Lord my God, listening to the cry and to the prayer that Your servant prays before You this day, that Your eyes may be open night and day toward this house, the place of which You have said, 'My name shall be there,' that You may listen to the prayer that Your servant offers toward this place, and listen to the plea of Your servant and of Your people Israel when they pray toward this place, and listen in heaven, Your dwelling place, and when You hear, forgive." Verse 31, "If a man sins against his neighbor and is made to take an oath and comes and swears his oath before Your altar in this house, then hear in heaven and act and judge Your servants, condemning the guilty by bringing his conduct on his own head and vindicating the righteous by rewarding him according to his righteousness. When Your people Israel are defeated before the enemy because they have sinned against You, and if they turn again to You and acknowledge Your name and pray and plead with You in this house, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of Your people Israel and bring them again to the land that You gave to Your to their fathers." Verse 35, "When heaven is set up and there is no rain because they have sinned against You, if they pray toward this place and acknowledge Your name and turn from their sin when You afflict them, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of Your servants, Your people Israel, when You teach them the good way in which they should walk, and grant rain upon Your land, which You have given to Your people as an inheritance." 37, "If there is famine in the land, if there is pestilence or blight or mildew or locust or caterpillar, if their enemy besieges them in the land of their gates, whatever plague, whatever sickness there is, whatever prayer, whatever plea is made by any man or by all Your people Israel, each knowing the affliction of his own heart and stretching out his hands toward this house, then hear in heaven Your dwelling place and forgive and act and render to each whose heart You know according to all his ways. For You only know the hearts of all the children of mankind, that they may fear You all the days that they live in the land that You give to our fathers." Verse 41, likewise, when a foreigner, who is not of your people Israel, comes from a far country for your name's sake, for they shall hear of your great name and your mighty hand and of your outstretched arm. When he comes and prays toward this house, hear in heaven your dwelling place, and do according to all for which the foreigner calls to you, in order that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and that they know that this house that I built is called by your name. If your people go out to battle against their enemy, by whatever way you shall send them, and they pray to the Lord toward the city that you have chosen, and the house that I built for your name, then hear in heaven their prayer and their plea and maintain their cause. If they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin. Oops, you write in your Bible, underline or highlight, verse 46. There is no one who does not sin. And you are angry with them and give to them an enemy, so that they are carried away captive to the land of the enemy, far off or near. Yet if they turn their heart in the land to which they have been carried captive, and repent and plead with you in the land of their captives, saying, we have sinned and have acted perversely and wickedly. If they repent with all their mind, with all their heart in the land of their enemy, who carried them captive, and pray to you toward their land, which you gave to their fathers, the city that you have chosen, and the house I have built for your name, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, their prayer and their plea, and maintain their cause, and forgive your people who have sinned against you, and all their transgressions that they have committed against you, and grant them compassion in the sight of those who carry them captive, that they may have compassion on them. For they are your people and your heritage, which you brought out of Egypt from the midst of the iron furnace. Let your eyes be open to the plea of your servant and to the plea of your people Israel, giving ear to them whenever they call to you. For you separated them from among all the peoples of the earth to be your heritage, as you declared to Moses your servant when you brought your fathers out of Egypt, O Lord God. Now, that's a long prayer, but there's one thing that's repeated in here several times. That's the key statement. So, I want you to look in verse 30. So, in verse 30, he says, and listen to the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray for this place, and listen in heaven, your dwelling place, and when you hear. Okay, some of you can't find verse 30. When you hear, forgive. Verse 34. Then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of your people. Verse 36. Then hear in heaven and. So, some of you that aren't looking at your Bible, you ought to figure it out by now what we're looking for. All right? Now look down at verse 39. Then hear in heaven your dwelling place and forgive. Now look down in verse 50. And what is the theme of these verses? Forgive. Now, there's something very interesting. This term, forgive, only occurs 46 times in the Old Testament. This particular word for forgive, 46 times. Of those 46 times, 5 of them are in this brief prayer. 1 out of every 9 occurrences, roughly, occur here in this prayer. Not only that, but the word forgive that's used here is only used with God as subject in the Bible. You and I can forgive one another, but only God can forgive sin. Only God can take away our guilt. And so, over and over and over and over again, Solomon says, here is the great theme of my prayer, that God would forgive us. Now, Wim Barclay has pointed out something very important about forgiveness. He says, there's one eternal principle which will be valid as long as the world lasts. The principle is, forgiveness is a costly thing. Human forgiveness is costly. A son or a daughter may go wrong. A father or a mother may forgive, but that forgiveness has brought tears. There was a price of a broken heart to pay. Divine forgiveness is costly. God is love, but God is holiness. God, least of all, can break the great moral laws on which the universe is built. Sin must have its punishment, or the very structure of life disintegrates. And God alone can pay the terrible price that is necessary before people can be forgiven. Forgiveness is never a case of saying it's all right, it doesn't matter. Forgiveness is the most costly thing in the world. And our forgiveness was the most costly thing in the world because it cost the life of God's Son, Jesus Christ, when He was crucified on the cross and rose again the third day. Our forgiveness was paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. Solomon says, what we need is the forgiveness of God. What makes this a place where worship can happen? The forgiveness of God. What makes us right with God? The forgiveness of God? What gives us encouragement to move through the day? The forgiveness of God. What stops us from being judgmental and arrogant? It is the forgiveness of God. What is it that binds and unites us as one people? It is the forgiveness of God. What is it that makes this temple the place they can worship? Because they are people who have been forgiven by God. Ben is done praying. He's now going to talk about the people of God. Verse 54. Now Solomon finished offering all this prayer and plea to the Lord. He arose from the altar of the Lord, where he had knelt with his hands outstretched toward heaven, and he stood and blessed all the assembly of Israel with a loud voice. You gotta be kidding me. He goes right back to praise. You know why? Because praise is important. And so he comes right back to praise before he now goes into the people of God, describing them. Verse 56. Blessed be the Lord God, who has given rest to his people Israel, according to all that he promised. Not one word has failed of all his good promise, which he spoke by Moses, his servant. The Lord our God be with us, as he was with our fathers. May not leave us or forsake us, that he may incline our hearts to him, to walk in all his ways and to keep his commandments and statutes and his rules, which he commanded our fathers. The people of God desire to be obedient to our God. The people of God desire to be obedient to our God, to follow His commandments and statutes and rules. Verse 59, let these words of mine, with which I pleaded before the Lord, be near to the Lord our God day and night, and may He maintain the cause of His servant and the cause of His people Israel, as each day requires. The word plead actually means grace, mercy. We plead for God when we plead for His mercy in our lives. Do you know what you and I need to get through every day? The mercy of God. It's the grace of God. And so he prays that God's people would experience God's mercy. And then, like verse 60, that all the peoples of the earth may know that the Lord is God, there is no other. This is not a prayer just for the people of Israel. It is a prayer for the nations. The people of God are not a group that are all alike. There is a tremendous variety. Listen, our great dream is to stand before the throne and to look around, and there is variety beyond imagination. People of every tribe, tongue, people, and nation, praising the one and only true God. We desire for the kingdom of God to grow. We want others to experience what we have experienced. We want them to know the forgiveness that has happened to us. We want them to become a part of our family. We are the people of God together. People of all the earth may know that He is the Lord. And then verse 31, let your heart, therefore, be wholly true to the Lord our God, walking His statutes and keeping His commandments as at this day. We want to be faithful. I want to finish well. Matter of fact, I want to finish better than I started. Now, I want you to notice all through here it's about people, the nations, groups, we, us. The reason is because Christianity is not what you do, it is what we do. It is who we are. Christianity is not a Lone Ranger religion. The Bible consistently portrays us in heaven standing with billions of other people. You don't stand at the throne alone. You stand with the people of God. We stand together. Matter of fact, our church mission statement is, we are helping each other to live genuine biblical lives 24/7. You do not do this journey alone. We are with you. We are together. Matter of fact, loneliness is bad. And it creates negative. In fact, in a recent issue of Psychology Today, they addressed the issue of loneliness, and this is what they said. Though our need to connect is innate, many of us frequently feel alone. Even some people who are surrounded by others throughout the day or in a long-lasting marriage still experience a deep and pervasive loneliness. Feelings of loneliness and isolation affect all types and ages of people, although some, like adolescents, are more likely to be impacted than others. The elderly are another high-risk group. In fact, research indicates that more than 20% of people over age 60 frequently feel intensely lonely. Not surprisingly, feelings of isolation can have a serious detrimental effect to one's mental and physical health. Loneliness can be a risk factor for heart disease, type 2 diabetes, arthritis, among other critical diseases. Lonely people are twice as likely to develop Alzheimer's. At the root, isolation compromises immunity, increases the production of stress hormones, and is harmful to sleep. All of this feeds chronic inflammation, which lowers immunity to the degree that lonely people even suffer more from the common cold. Loneliness can be a chronic stress condition that ages the body and causes damage to the overall well-being. Listen to me. We are not alone. We are a family. We are the people of God, and we care for one another, and we care for you. And so Solomon addresses the people of God. And then, verses 62 to 66, they decide to have a party for God. That's right. Look what verse 62 says. Then the king and all Israel with him offered sacrifice before the Lord. Solomon offered his peace offerings to the Lord, 22,000 oxen and 120,000 sheep. Man, that's a barbecue. So the king and all the people of Israel dedicated the house of the Lord. The same day, the king consecrated the middle of the court that was before the house of the Lord. Now, why would he do that? For there he offered the burnt offering and the grain offering and the fat pieces of the peace offerings, because the bronze altar that was before the Lord was too small to receive the burnt offering, the grain offering, and the fat pieces of the peace offerings. They were offering so much they had to set up some temporary altars because they were giving so much to the Lord. So Solomon held the feast, that's the Feast of Booths, held the feast at that time, and all Israel with him, a great assembly, from Lebo Hamath to the brook of Egypt, before the Lord our God, 7 days. On the eighth day, he sent the people away, and they blessed the king and went to their homes joyful and glad of heart for all the goodness that the Lord had shown to David his servant and to Israel his people. Now, I want you to think about this. If someone who knew nothing about Christianity was to show up and look at us on a Sunday morning, I would guess the majority would say they want nothing to do with that. I see the faces. Many of you look like, before you walk in this building, you sucked down a half a dozen lemons raw. I mean, you got the most sourpuss look on your face. You look so unhappy. Who in the world wants a Christianity that is so unhappy, that is so unkind, that is so serious? I want to share a four-letter word with you that people don't like to use in church. All right, it's a three-letter word, but lots of people don't want to connect it with church. It's the word fun. Fun. Do you notice what happened? They went home joyful and glad of heart. What in the world would your friends think? And asked, what did you do this weekend? He said, man, I went to church. And when I left, I was joyful and glad of heart. It was so great, praising God, I didn't even leave. All right, I had you go and say amen until I dropped the last line on you. But we should leave joyful. We have been here celebrating that we have been forgiven by the King of the universe, and we are part of His family and a part of His kingdom. We have all cause to leave with joy and gladness of heart. And I think, it would do us some good to realize that praise is good for us and that God is to be enjoyed. I mean, think about it. If God's always serious and unhappy, do you really want to be around His throne forever? Boy, God was especially dour today. I was touched by the frown He was able to maintain for hours on end. Is that the God you want to worship? It's not the God I want to worship. I want heaven to be full of joy. Gladness of heart. So that they have this great party. They have a great time. Did you know that you will not find praise in the Bible connected to anything outside of joy and excitement? Praise and worship is to be fun. It's to lift us up. This is what God has created us to be. Worshippers. Not unhappy, gloomy, sourpuss, run everybody off kind of people. There is great joy in being forgiven. You don't sound very joyful. There is great joy in being forgiven. There we go. That's right. Now, there is this thread that runs through the whole thing. It goes through this whole passage. And it's the thread that ends up through the passage. It's the thread that runs through all of your life. The thread that should run through all of my life. It's the thread that's run through everything we do. It can be found in one word. Forgiven. Solomon has repeated it over and over and over again. Forgiven. What is it that motivates you to praise? It's like you've been forgiven. What is it that motivates you to want to be obedient to God? You're forgiven. What is it that brings joy into your life? You've been forgiven. What is it that allows you to even come to God and lift up your prayers? The fact that you have been forgiven. What is it that binds us together as one people? It is the fact that we have been forgiven. This is the thread that ties all the Bible together, ties all of our lives together, ties the message of God together. This is what allows us to spend forever in heaven. The fact that we have been forgiven. And you will lose the joy of Christianity when you forget the greatness of your forgiveness. This is what happens to people. This is why Christians become so judgmental and arrogant and mean-spirited and unhappy and all these other things. Because we forget how great is our forgiveness. We lose the joy of having them. We kind of get to a point where we almost think like, you know, sort of like we deserved it. Like, you know, we really haven't been that bad. You know, we got, no. Listen. Jesus said, the physician doesn't come for those who are well, he comes for those who are sick. We are not saints who have it all together. We are sinners who have been forgiven. So here's the way that it works. Joyful saints know that they are forgiven sinners. Joyful saints know that they are forgiven sinners. And when you forget the joy, the immensity, the greatness of the price that God paid for our forgiveness, you will lose the joy of Christianity. You will lose the capacity to praise like you should. But when you reflect on the forgiveness that we have in Jesus Christ, it will lead you to praise. It will give you joy and a glad heart.